Hello everybody, I'm not in the shop today, so I thought I would do a video. This is going to be a talking head video, I guess, unfortunately, but also, unfortunately, I don't quite have the time and technological ability to make some really cool videos, but I wanted to provide some useful content if at all possible. So hopefully that's what this is, and this is continuing the series for the beginner knife maker or someone who's interested in the process of custom knife making. And the last video I did in the series was four things to know about knife or buying knife steel. And so if you haven't seen that, check that out. Really, so I'm kind of trying to build from the ground up, and really there's any number of things I could talk about from that point after talking about knife steel briefly. But what I wanted to talk about today and cover just very broadly is the subject of knife making quenchants, or quenchants that you use for the heat treating process or in the heat treating process for making knives when you harden the blade specifically. And so let me just say right out of the gate that this is going to be about commercially made quenchants that are engineered and designed for quenching hot steel, and I'm sure other types of metals as well. I'm not going to talk about alternative quenchants, and by alternative I mean everything else besides commercially engineered quenchants, which are usually oils. I think that alternative quenchants have a place sometimes, but that discussion is a whole different thing, and I'm not going to get into that today. So, commercially made quenchants. So the first thing that you need to know is the particular steel that you're working with requires a particular type of quenchant. And the reason is to get the maximum capability out of that steel. And so, also just a note, I'm going to work from a perfect world scenario. And because if at all possible, we want to use the best technology and procedures that we have available to us. So I'm going to talk as if I'm assuming that we have the ability to do that. And I understand that not everybody has the ability to cover all of these, but we're going to talk about it from that perspective. So every particular steel has a specific need for a quenchant when you're heat treating it to get what you can out of the steel, what's possible out of the steel. So so I'll say right off the bat that whatever the type of steel that you're working with, you're going to have to research that for yourself and figure out what is required for that type of steel that you're working with. And I'm going to talk about a few of the steels and quenchants that I use just to make it a little more simple and try to keep things on the rails here without getting off onto any number of rabbit trails that would be easy to do. So the steels that some of the steels that I use a lot are 01 tool steel. Use some 1095 high carbon steel, ADCRV2, use some AEBL stainless, S35VN, which is also a stainless. There's a couple others, 5160. So, and just in those steels that I just mentioned, I utilize at least three different types of quenchants, specific quenching mediums for those range of steels. Because the requirements range very broadly in that just those ones that I mentioned. And this has to do with the alloying components that are in the steel. So anytime you change the chemistry of the steel, even just a little bit, that can drastically affect how it reacts to heat treating procedure and so forth. So that's just something you have to be aware of with the particular type of steel that you're using. So let's use 1095 high carbon steel as an example. Pretty common steel, probably not the best steel for a beginner because the heat treating process is a little more complicated than some people think, or a lot of people think, but nevertheless, we'll use that as an example. And so 1095 high carbon steel requires what's known as a very fast quench. And so that's when you heat your steel up to austenitizing temperature, which for 1095 is between 1450 and 1500 degrees, and you quench it in your quenchant, the rate at which it needs to be cooled from that austenitizing temperature down to, it's about 900 degrees, is very quick. It's less than a second. So And so why this is important is so the steel can convert as fully as possible to martensitic structure or full hardness is what we're talking about for the steel. If you quench your 1095 high carbon steel blade in something that doesn't cool it quickly enough, you might get a little bit, it might have some hardness to it, but it will not be even close to what it should be. So that's why that's important. Now, by contrast, 01 tool steel is one of the steels that's known as a deep hardening steel, and it has about the same percentage of carbon in it, but it has multiple additional alloying elements to it that drastically affect how it reacts to heat treating procedure. And so by contrast, the speed at which 01 tool steel needs to be cooled from critical temperature down to around that 900 degree temperature is closer to 5 seconds as opposed to less than a second. And so you can see from just those two examples how much steel can vary. So different steels require different quenchants and procedure to get the potential out of that particular steel. And this is also why matching your steel for the specific knife or job is also an important thing, but again, I'm not going to get into that. In practice, the quenchant that you would use for something like 1095 high carbon steel that requires a very fast quenchant could be something like water. That's a very fast quenchant. It pulls heat away very quickly. The inherent problem with that, however, is that in a high carbon steel like 1095, that the rate of cooling that water provides is so drastic that it creates extreme amounts of internal stress, and more often than not, you're going to crack and ruin your blade. And so few people use water. I don't know of anybody who does. You'll find some people using water for slightly lower carbon steels, lower than 1085, when they're doing things like Japanese style blade making with the hormones, with the clay packing and that kind of thing. But that's a different thing. And I'm gonna focus on sort of the general standard practice of custom knife makers. So what we use for a very fast quenchant for 1095 is what's known as a very fast oil. And that's about a 7 second oil. And then for 01, for example, you can use anything from a 10 second to a 14 second oil to adequately harden those steels. Okay, so now we need to stop here and talk about what is a 7 second oil, what's a 10 second oil, 14, you know, up to 20 something and so forth. What does that mean? Great question. So where this second denomination comes from is what's known as the nickel ball test. Excuse me, I think that one of the terms was a quenchometer test, but I think the General Motors Corporation developed it decades ago. And you can look it up for yourself. It's good in research for yourself, but just quoting from memory, talking about from memory and telling you what it is, it was a nickel ball of a specific size. I want to say it's around, 3/4, but don't quote me on that. 3/4 of an inch, don't quote me on that. Nickel ball heated up to a specific temperature, and again, I think it was something like 1600 or 1650 degrees. Don't quote me on that either. Which was suspended from some type of wire and submerged in a specific amount of quenchant in a container that had a magnet on the side. And of course, at high extreme temperatures, steel, iron, nickel, they're not magnetic. And so as the nickel ball cooled down, at the point that it became magnetic again, it would swing over to the magnet, be attracted by the magnet, and stop the timer. And so that is where that seconds comes from. So in a 7 second oil, that nickel ball would be submerged in 7 seconds, would be cooled enough to be magnetic again. So it's important to note that all the nickel ball test does is tell you how quickly a particular coolant will cool a nickel ball of a specific size heated to a specific temperature from temperature X to temperature Y. Now obviously that's useful, but it's also it also doesn't directly translate all the time either, so that's important to note that. So that's where the seconds of oil come from, you know, 7, 10, whatever. Now, a 7-second oil is considered a very fast oil, and that's what we use for something like 1095 picogram steel. So let me also, real quick, I was going to mention, the nickel ball test is sort of outdated because all it does is tell you how quickly it cools from temperature X to temperature Y on that specific specimen. What it doesn't tell you is what that graphed path of temperatures is as it reaches that in between those two temperatures. So what I'm talking about is the engineered coolants that we have today that are very sophisticated compared to, you know, multiple decades ago, to my knowledge, they are designed to cool at a specific rate between certain temperatures, and then once it's cooled to a specific temperature, the cooling rate slows down, and that's by design to minimize stress in your steel parts and so forth. So that's a good thing, but the nickel ball test doesn't tell you any of that. That's just a side note. So when we're talking about knife blade steel, another concept that I would just want to very briefly introduce to you is the triple T diagram, time, temperature, and transformation. This is, I'm not going to get into it in any depth. That's a great subject for another video, and you can research that yourself too. But basically what that is it's a chart, a graphed chart of sorts, with information that tells you, for our purposes for this video right here, it will tell you how quickly you need to cool that steel from critical temperature to approximately below 900 degrees, or a temperature that will avoid pearlitic structure forming in your steel. Because if you don't cool quickly enough, you will start to form pearlite in your steel, which is not what we want. We want martensite, and as close to full martensitic conversion as possible. So hopefully that kind of gives you an idea of what you're looking at when you go to pair up your steel with the appropriate quenchant. I'll just talk briefly also about other forms of quenchant. Quenchants, not alternative quenchants, but quenchants for high alloy steels that have a much longer period of time you have to cool that steel to reach full hardness. And so in often those cases we'll use stuff like aluminum plates that you sandwich the blade after it comes out of the heating source, and it pulls the heat away from the blade much quicker than just still air or even compressed air. And so that's a form of quenching that you often use on very thin cross sections of high alloy steel, for example. And then there's other steels that will reach full hardness in an air quench. So it just really depends on the type of steel. Generally speaking, a beginner knife maker is going to be using the type of steel that requires an oil quench to reach full hardness, full martensitic conversion, at least as close to as possible without bringing the temperature below room temperature. And that gets into another subject that I won't cover, sub-zero and cryogenic quenching, but that's sort of the overall idea. Now, another thing I should talk about quickly is availability and where to purchase your quenchant. Now, that's sort of one of the bigger issues with getting quenching. You can get it and you can find it, but it's not necessarily easy. There are a lot of different companies that make very good quenchants out there. The difficulty that you might run into is finding it in quantities that are practical for us knife makers. Like, I don't need 55 gallons in a drum, and you probably don't either. So finding a dealer that sells it in a 5-gallon pail, or even in quantities as small as a gallon, you know, you're going to end up paying obviously more per gallon or whatever, but it is what it is. I use an 11-second oil for deep hardening steels and things like that, and I buy that from truegrit.com. That is the best source I've found for that type of oil. And then as far as a very fast oil, which is the equivalent of what's called Parks 50, and it's a 7-second oil, Park 50 is not made anymore, but it's the equivalent. I purchased that from a guy named Kelly Couples, and he's a dealer for the company that makes that oil. I think it's, I can't remember the name of the company now, but anyway, you can get it in a 5 gallon pail at a reasonable price. Shipping's a touch expensive, but it should last a long time. So those are my two sources that I use, and you can find others. It also depends on the region that you're in. If you live back east or Midwest, where there's been more industry by far than out west here for a long time, and a lot of times you can find other resources, but that's what I use out where I'm at. And there's other places online too that you can purchase Quenchants. Now, getting back to the original theme of what I was talking about, you know, beware, because I have seen knife supply companies selling an oil, a quenching oil, on the same page as a steel that it is not, it's not made for. Like if you, it's not, for example, like selling a 10 or 15 or 10 or 11, 14 second oil on the same page as, you know, 1095 high carbon steel, like buy your knife steel, then buy your oil, and it's not even the oil that's appropriate for that steel. So be aware of that. So hopefully this video helps with that whole process, and hopefully it was useful in some way. Say hi, Maggie. Say hi to the camera.
Hi.
And yeah, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.